I'd like to invite you to open your Bibles to the 7th chapter of Revelation. Verse 1, after these things I saw four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree. And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea. And verse 3, saying, hurt not the earth, neither the sea, nor the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God in their foreheads. And I heard the number of them which were sealed, and there were sealed 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel. And then he goes on in verse 5, and he mentions a couple of the tribes, and on down through 12,000 from each of the tribes of Israel. The seal of the living God. In Revelation 14, we have this similar group mentioned, same group, because there are 144,000. And in Revelation chapter 14, verses 1 through 5, and I looked, and lo, a lamb stood on the Mount Zion, and with him 144,000, having his father's name written in their foreheads. And I heard a voice from heaven, as the voice of many waters, and as the voice of great thunder. And I heard the voice of harpers harping with their harps. And, verse 3, and they sung, as it were, a new song before the throne, and before the four beasts, and the elders. And no man could learn that song but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. Verses 4 and 5. For these are they which were not defiled with women, for they are virgins. These are they which follow the Lamb, whithersoever he goeth. These were redeemed from among men, being the firstfruits unto God and to the Lamb. And in their mouth was found no guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. Friends, you will not get the seal of God if you are teaching false doctrine, if you're teaching error. So what is the seal of God, and what does it mean to have the seal of God? As Seventh-day Adventists, we understand the basic fundamental points of this. Brother Sims shared on this already. But we know that the purpose of a sign or a seal normally is to give a document authority, to show that it's not to be changed, to show what belongs to whom. And no religious group has so extensively studied and considered the seal of God like Seventh-day Adventists. No doubt this is due to the many statements, at least in part, that Ellen White has written about this concept. And as perhaps, I hope, mature Adventists, we're knowledgeable about the claims of the fourth commandment when God said, as it is in Isaiah 8:16, bind up the testimony, seal the law among my disciples. And the one commandment in the law that expresses the quality of a seal, the seal of God, is the Sabbath commandment. And we've been told in the book Maranatha on page 200 that just as soon as the people of God are sealed in their foreheads, it is not any seal or mark that can be seen, but a settling in to the truth, both intellectually and spiritually, so that they cannot be moved. Just as soon as God's people are sealed and prepared for the shaking, it will come. Indeed, it has begun already. The judgments of God are now upon the land to give us warning that we may know what is coming. There's a settling in to the what?
Truth
that we need, friends. It's not an adoption of a new theology or a new way. In this study, I want to examine the seal of God from the perspective of the vision of Ezekiel. Ezekiel claimed, in fact, in Ezekiel chapter 1, verse 1, he says, now it came to pass in the 13th year, in the 4th month, in the 5th day of the month, as I was among the captives by the river Chebar, that the heavens were opened, and I saw visions of God. Visions of God. Ezekiel experienced a theophany, or an appearing of God. In chapters 2 and 3, we have the prophet's commission and charge given to him. In chapters 4 through 7, there is a series of indictments given in the book of Ezekiel against God's people because of their transgressions, which would result in three judgments: the sword, famine, and pestilence. Furthermore, in Ezekiel 6:4 and Ezekiel 7:10 and 11, God speaks of Judah's idolatry, pride, and violence. And these things finally climax in the vision of four abominations in chapter 8, and the seal of God for the righteous, and the slaughter of the wicked in chapter 9. In fact, if we could turn to chapter 9, we'll read verses 1 through 6. Ezekiel chapter 9, verses 1 through 6. He cried also in my ears with a loud voice, saying, cause them that have charge over the city to draw near, even every man with his destroying weapon in his hand. And behold, six men came from the way of the higher gate, which lieth toward the north, and every man a slaughter weapon in his hand. And one man among them was clothed with linen, with a writer's inkhorn by his side. And they went in and stood beside the brazen altar. Verse 3. And the glory of the God of Israel was gone up from the cherub, whereupon he was, to the threshold of the house. And he called to the man clothed with linen, which had the writer's inkhorn by his side. And the Lord said unto him, go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and set a mark upon the foreheads of the men that sigh and that cry, for all the abominations that be done in the midst thereof. And verses 5 and 6. And to the others he said in mine hearing, go ye after him through the city, and smite. Let not your eyes spare, neither have ye pity. Slay utterly, old and young, both maids and little children, and women. But come not near any man upon whom is the mark, and begin at my sanctuary. Then they began at the ancient men which were before the house. And I will go ahead and tell you that as you come near the end of the vision, the angel comes back and he says, we have done what you've told us to do. It is clear that what happens in chapter 9 is a result of a judgment that has prior taken place. There are two classes, and only two classes at this time, friends. There is one that is cut down by the destroying angels, and the other class which receives a mark in their foreheads. And this mark is given to one group, those who receive the seal of the living God. And we read about that group in Revelation chapter 7 and Revelation chapter 14. They are the 144,000, or at least 144,000 are part of those who receive the seal of God. And they are described as having the Father's name written in their foreheads, Revelation 14:1. They are redeemed from the earth. They are virgins. They are without guile, for they are without fault before the throne of God. I don't think it should be surprising to find the Sabbath as an issue in this judgment and in this sealing. But like the book of Revelation, the Sabbath may not be directly mentioned here. But if we will simply dig below the surface, we will certainly find what's being said. And yet there is a characteristic of those who receive the seal of God that is clearly and plainly stated. Ezekiel 9:4 gives the requirements of those who receive what Ellen White calls the pure mark of truth, volume 3, page 267. This pure mark of truth, this seal of God, has a characteristic, and it says that those who receive the seal of God are those who sigh and cry for all the abominations that are done in the midst of Jerusalem. Now, in Ezekiel chapter 8, God revealed to Ezekiel abominations that were occurring in Jerusalem. Chapters 8 and 9 of Ezekiel make up what I will call an enacted prophecy. These were literal events that were happening in Jerusalem. Remember now, Ezekiel was a prophet of captivity. He was by the river Chebar. Jeremiah prophesied in Jerusalem. Ezekiel was in captivity. And God had showed him things that were occurring, literally happening in Jerusalem, that were prophetic of things that were going to happen in the end of time among God's people. The end time setting is impossible to miss, friends, unless we bury our heads in spiritual sand and fail to see. The servant of the Lord has plainly stated concerning this prophecy, after quoting these verses from Ezekiel that we quoted just a minute ago, she said, Jesus is about to leave the mercy seat of the heavenly sanctuary. The prophet, looking down the ages, had this time presented before his vision. She's speaking about our time. This time was presented before him in this vision. That's volume 5, page 207, 208. And then she says in volume 3, of the testimonies on page 266, especially in the closing work for the church, in the sealing time of the 144,000 who are to stand without fault before the throne of God, will they feel most deeply the wrongs of God's professed people. This is forcibly set forth by the prophet's illustration of the last work under the figure of the men, each having a slaughter weapon in his hand. One man among them clothed with linen, with a writer's inkhorn by his side. There's a lot to chew on right there, and I'll let you chew on that. But in the last days, the only people, Sister Faye, who are going to be sealed are those who sigh and cry for all the abominations that be done in the midst of Jerusalem. And here, clearly, Jerusalem is a symbol of the church. Mm-hmm. Also, in Testimonies for the Church, and this is volume 3, I'm sorry, I don't have the volume number, it's volume 3, page 267. Ellen White says, mark this point with care. And friends, everything in the testimonies, everything in the Bible should be marked with care. You remember William Miller, as he studied in his rules of interpretation, he says that every word, every line has to have its place and bearing, right? But whenever inspiration says you mark something with care, friends, that means you need to pay attention. This is important. Those who receive the pure mark of truth, we made reference to that a little bit ago, those who receive the pure mark of truth wrought in them by the power of the Holy Ghost, represented by a mark by the man in linen, are those that sigh and that cry for all the abominations that be done, where?
In the church.
In the church. In Ezekiel, it says Jerusalem, but she says in the church, she's saying Jerusalem is symbolic of the church here. So, we should have a red flag coming up to us because we're to mark this point with care. This is important, friends. We cannot just let this pass by easily. There is a special work for the church, for God's church in the end of time, and only those who participate in this work will receive the seal of God. God's people, friends, will only receive this seal if they sigh and cry for the abominations that are done in the church. However, if I do not know what the abominations are, how can I sigh and how can I cry for them? Does that make sense? Is that reasonable? Well, where are these abominations mentioned? Specifically, there are four great abominations mentioned in the 8th chapter of Ezekiel. And we don't have time to study through them right now, but I did a series in OPAS in February through June of 2010. They're online. We can get you hard copies if you need. You can study these through in detail. But the first abomination was what was called the image of jealousy. And it corresponds to the sun pillars and the obelisks that those people used in those days. And we have modern day images of jealousy today. And, for instance, church steeples. These are phallic symbols that were used in their worship, and they have no place in Christianity. The second abomination dealt with all the creeping things and abominable beasts and the idols of the house of Israel portrayed upon the walls round about. They would create murals and drawings of all of their deities and idols and things that they worshipped. And then the third abomination was women weeping for Tammuz, a false Christ, or if you please, the second person of the Trinity. And the last abomination was 25 men with their backs to the temple facing the east, worshiping the sun. God calls all of these things abominations. Brother Andy, you talked about abominations earlier. These are abominations. And that word that's translated abomination in Hebrew is tuabah. And it means something that is abhorring, something that is disgusting to God, something that is repulsive to Him. These manners of false worship and these forms of false worship are repulsive to God. Just some other examples in case we haven't saw or heard Brother Andy's message. But God says some of the things that He calls abomination in the Bible. Homosexuality, other terrible perversions in Leviticus 18, 22 through 26, idolatry, Deuteronomy 7, 25, even human sacrifice, Deuteronomy 12, 31, occult activities, Deuteronomy 18, 9 through 14, by the context of the usage of tuabah, we can see what is described by the word is something that doesn't please God. It's something that is repulsive and abhorring to Him. It is foul, nauseating, and disgusting. And when God says these four wicked practices in Ezekiel 8 are abominations, God is making His attitude toward them well known. Mm-hmm. Now, the reason to have a background in understanding these abominations is that only those who sigh and cry over them, being done in the church, receive the seal of God. Now, they're not the only things that we are to sigh and cry over, but these are main important points. Now, I'd like to say that, and by the way, this is the Hebrew word tuabah here. It's translated abomination. I'd like to say that I believe that perhaps the most important testimony Ellen White ever wrote is found in Volume 5 of the Testimonies on pages 207 to 216. It's entitled The Seal of God. The seal of God is present truth if we have ever had present truth. The testimony begins by quoting Ezekiel chapter 9, verses 1 through 6, and discusses how God had in times past kept an account of the nations. She says on page 208, "With unerring accuracy, the Infinite One still keeps an account with all nations. While His mercy is tendered with calls to repentance, this account will remain open. But when the figures reach a certain amount, which God has fixed, the ministry of His wrath commences. The account is closed. Divine patience ceases. There is no more pleading of mercy in their behalf." She goes on to say, "But that which causes me to tremble is the fact that those who have had the greatest light and privileges have become contaminated by their prevailing iniquity." She's speaking about God's people being contaminated with the kinds of iniquity that God will judge the nations for. She also says on page 209 and 210, she says, "The crisis is fast approaching." Do you remember when Volume 8, or at least this part of Volume 8, was written? 1882. In 1882, she said, "The crisis is fast approaching." I think she would say, you know, we've been traveling along at 100 miles an hour, and we're this far from the brick wall right now. Do you get what I mean? In other words, we've been coming, it's fast approaching, but now we're right here against the brick wall, and we're still going 100 miles an hour. Today, it is more than fast approaching. The rapidly swelling figures show that the time for God's visitation has about come. Although loath to punish, nevertheless He will punish, and that speedily. Those who walk in the light will see signs of the approaching peril, but they are not to sit in quiet, unconcerned expectancy of the ruin, comforting themselves with the belief that God will shelter His people in the day of visitation. Far from it. Many people said in the church pews today, "God will never bring judgment on our church. He won't do that." She says, far from it, from that thought. The leaven of godliness has not entirely lost its power. I'm continuing in Volume 5, pages 209, 210. The leaven of godliness has not entirely lost its power. At the time when the danger and depression of the church are the greatest, the little company who are standing in the light will be sighing and crying for the abominations that are done in the land, but more especially will their prayers arise in behalf of the church, because its members are doing after the manner of the world. And she calls them a little company. Elsewhere she calls them the faithful few, and we're going to find there's another expression she uses that indicates a small number in this one testimony. Now Ezekiel 4 says that only those who sigh and cry for these abominations are going to get the mark, the seal of God. So what does that mean? Ellen White defines it something like this. She says they had reproved, counseled, entreated, expressed in lamentation and weeping reproofs and warnings. And so, friends, today I may give some counsel. I may entreat today, and I'm certainly going to reprove today. Because I want the seal of God.
Amen.
Do you want the seal of God?
Amen.
I want the seal of God. Friends, how serious is this?
Yes.
I'm going to tell you, it's serious enough that life and death hang on it. And the faithful few, those little group, are going to be so devoted that, Ellen White says, while others try to throw a cloak over the existing evil and excuse the great wickedness everywhere prevalent, those who have a zeal for God's honor and a love for souls will not hold their peace to obtain the favor of any. Let me just pause there. Sometimes we have to say things that we know people won't want to hear, that aren't palatable. And we don't ever should do that, friends, just to create an argument, just to create dissension or problems. But it says here that if we have an honor of God and we love souls, that we will not hold our peace to obtain the favor of any. It says their religious souls are vexed day by day with the unholy works and conversation of the unrighteous. She goes on to say, they are powerless to stop the rushing torrent of iniquity, and hence they are filled with grief and alarm. They mourn before God to see religion despised in the very homes of those who have had great light. They lament and afflict their souls because pride, avarice, selfishness, and deception of almost every kind are at the capital of the United States of America.
Church.
It says what? It says in the church. But this statement says that those who are sighing and crying are going to be powerless to stop the rushing torrent.
Mm-hmm.
It's called a torrent of iniquity, and they're filled with grief and alarm. Friends, I want to tell you right now, there's this idea that if we just pray enough, and if we just say enough, and if we just study enough, and if we just help people enough, that the church is going to turn around.
Mm-hmm.
Ellen White says that those people who are trying to do this, they're going to be powerless to stop it. We can't help the corporate structure, friends. It can't be helped. And I'm going to show you many other things before we're done to show you that. And I don't have any beef with anyone in the corporate structure. I love these people, see? I love them, but I have to also honor God, right?
Amen. That's
right. It says, they mourn before God to see religion despised in the very homes, but it goes through into the church as well. This little company is powerless to stop the torrent of iniquity. Have you thought about, a torrent? What is a torrent? It's a fast-moving stream. And you've seen pictures of these floods where the water is coming through a town, for instance, and here's the cars just moving right down through with it, and you can't stop it.
Mm-hmm.
You can't stop that. We are also told concerning this crisis of the Alpha and the Omega, which ties into this, that nothing would be allowed to stand in the way of the new movement. Select the Messages, Book 1, page 205. We are told that the faithful mourn. The faithful mourn. And this is Day of Atonement language, friends. And we have been told, and I don't want you to forget this, we are now living in the Great Day of Atonement, Great Controversy 49. If there was ever a book Ellen White wrote that is a book of truth, if there was ever a book that she wrote that's important to us today, it is that book. That is the most important book we have outside of the Bible, I believe. And she says, and in many other places too, that we are now, since 1844, in the time of the investigative judgment, we are living in the Day of Atonement. This is the final Day of Atonement, friends. Please remember that. We're going to come back to it later. But remember, it is those that sigh and that cry for these abominations that receive the mark in their foreheads. But what about those who aren't grieved? What about those who maybe don't understand or don't care? Well, in volume 5, on page 211, we're told that the class who do not feel grieved over their own spiritual declensions, nor mourn over the sins of others, will be left without the seal of God. I've got to be concerned, first and foremost, about me. You know, it's me, O Lord, standing in the need of prayer, right? But there's also a work to do. for the people. In Ezekiel, again, chapter 9, they were to begin this judgment with the ancient men which were before the house. And in volume 5 on page 211, she says, here we see that the church, the Lord's sanctuary, was the first to feel the stroke of the wrath of God. Why does the church feel this wrath? Why does the church feel this wrath? Have you ever seen one of these? In volume 5, page 83, Ellen White made a statement. She says, the church will be weighed in the balances of the sanctuary if her moral character and spiritual state do not correspond with the benefits and blessings God has conferred upon her. She will be found what? Wanting. Now, this statement was written shortly before the Seal of God chapter was written. And she said the church will be weighed. And what happens depends upon her spiritual condition. And I think that we all should be able to understand what that spiritual condition is today. It's not hard to cipher through. All these abominations of Ezekiel, except the very last one, are present in the church, and it's fast flooding in. 1 Peter 4:17, for the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God. And if it first begin at us, what shall be the end of them that obey not the gospel? Do you think the gospel, friends, is to be believed?
Yes.
Well, yeah. But is it also to be obeyed?
Yes.
That's what it says. Now, I'm going to read you a statement or two that just calls me to shudder. It brings deep anguish to my heart, and I hope it does yours too. I hope it has an effect upon you. In volume 5 on page 211, Ellen White says, the ancient men, those to whom God had given great light and who had stood as guardians of the spiritual interests of the people, had betrayed their trust. God had given them a sacred trust and they had betrayed it. They had taken the position that we need not look for miracles and the marked manifestation of God's powers in former days. Times have changed. These words strengthen their unbelief, and they say, the Lord will not do good, neither will He do evil. He is too merciful to visit His people in judgment. Thus, peace and safety is the cry for men who will never again lift up their voice like a trumpet to show God's people their transgressions and the house of Jacob their sins. These dumb dogs, she's quoting from Isaiah, these dumb dogs that would not bark are the ones who feel the just vengeance of an offended God. In fact, Isaiah says they cannot bark. Isaiah says they cannot bark. They're either tied into their paycheck so much or a system so much that they can't speak. And you can think of compromising men today. The false prophet John Christophe talked about the other day. Remember what his name was?
No.
Ted Wilson. I remember. I'll say it. These men, Leroy Froom, Roy On Anderson, B.B. Beach, and I'm going to tell you other men who are teaching the same doctrines and saying the same thing, that they must stay at the church to be saved. And you can put in Walter Vyth, you can put in Doug Batchelor. And if you ever get to hear this message of Doug Batchelor, if you're hearing this, I love you, brother, but this is the truth, that we cannot continue to try to tell people to stay in an apostate organization and teach the central doctrine of the whore of Rome.
Yes.
Is that right?
Yes.
Yes.
You might think of these compromising men, ministers who have joined us to the evangelicals. You might reason, well, you know what? They deserve it. Let them perish. But neither the text nor the testimony finish there. Men, maidens, and little children all perish together. Volume 5, page 211, and in Ezekiel 9, 6, they were to slay young, both maids and little children and women. Think about that. Think about that if you have a little child named Elliot, maybe. Or if you have young children, maybe named Zachariah or Rebecca, you know. Or Graham, someone like that. Or the ladies. It's a solemn thought, isn't it, now?
Yes.
We say, well, they weren't ringleaders in this apostasy. Why must they, the maidens, and even the little children perish too? Friends, for two reasons. There is, and God does hold His people accountable as a body. There is a corporate accountability involved, but also their association with this corporation and its teachings and practices have so corrupted them that they cannot be saved. You remember when God commissioned Saul, for instance, to go destroy Amalek, and to not leave anything. Even the children had to perish because even the children were so corrupted that they couldn't be saved. Parents, think about this. Think about it. Think about this when you take your children and put them in a Sabbath school or worship service where Satan's theology is spread. You think about it. Think about when you subject yourself to these thoughts and remember that 2 Corinthians 3:18 is truth and Galatians 6:7 says God will not be mocked. Do you remember what 2 Corinthians 3:18 says? We with all, with open face, beholding in the glass, are changing the same image of the Lord from glory to glory, even as by the Spirit of the Lord. In other words, by beholding, you become changed. And you put yourself in that environment, and I don't care how strong you think you are, after a while, it's going to affect you.
Yes.
Inspiration says that no church membership nor position will save us in these coming times. Also in Volume 5 on page 212, it says, those who have been regarded as worthy and righteous. Oh, they were great men. They were the Walter Weiss and the Doug Batchelors. Proved to be ringleaders in apostasy and examples in indifference and in the abuse of God's mercy. Their wicked course He will tolerate no longer. And in His wrath He deals with them, how? Without mercy. Men, maidens, and little children all perish together. Now, where in the Bible do you read about God's wrath without mercy? Revelation chapter 14, verses 9 and 10. The third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, if any man worship the beast and his image and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture. Without what? No dilution. Into the cup of His indignation. And so, friends, those people, those ringleaders here, the people who receive God's wrath without any mercy, are those who receive the mark of the beast. And in chapter 16 of Revelation, you have the plagues. And these plagues are also poured out upon the people who worship the beast in His image. And so the unsealed people. And where does that judgment begin? It begins at the ancient men of the house. They are going to receive the mark of the beast and receive the first plague.
Yes.
They'll be the first. The Adventist ministers will be the first people to receive the first plague.
Mm-hmm.
Now I want to ask you a question. If I have a church that no longer has the Bible as the final authority, if I have a church that teaches the central doctrine of the Trinity, if I have a church that's lessening the distance between itself and the papacy, and how close were they the other day, John Christoph?
0 inches.
0 inches. 0 inches. There was the hand of the Adventist clasped with the hand of the Pope.
Yes.
Man of sin.
The man of sin. I just ask you, can this be a church that God approves of?
No.
Could this be a church that can receive the mark of the beast? Ellen White says in this same testimony on page 212, volume 5, page 212, that it is with reluctance that the Lord does something. What is it? He withdraws His presence. He withdraws His presence from those who have been blessed with great light and who have felt the power of the Word in ministering to others. They were once his faithful servants, favored with his presence and guidance, but they departed from him and led others into error, and therefore are brought under divine displeasure. They left the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ for the God of the Trinity. They left the Savior of all mankind who could succor us for a false Christ who could not help them to overcome sin. How soon is this to come to pass? It must be very soon. Ellen White wrote these words in 1882. She also noted this: the day of God's vengeance is just upon us. The seal of God will be placed upon the foreheads of those only who sigh and cry for all the abominations that be done in the land. And I just ask you a question. Do you believe that?
Yes.
Do you believe this testimony today? Maybe she made a mistake here.
No.
Maybe she's in error here. Do you believe she's in error?
No.
Are you sure?
Yes.
Well, you have an individual responsibility. Because she tells us, continuing on page 212, our own course of action will determine whether we shall receive the seal of the living God or be cut down by the destroying weapons. Already a few drops of God's wrath have fallen upon the earth, but when the seven last plagues shall be poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, then it will be forever too late to repent and find shelter. No atoning blood will then wash away the stains of sin. Daniel 12:1 is soon to come upon us. Michael is going to stand up, and there's going to be a time of trouble such as never was. Probation will close, and when it closes, it will close for eternity. Forever. Remember we read about the little company, the faithful few, and they're also called the small remnant. Unable to defend themselves in the deadly conflict with the powers of earth that are marshaled by the dragon host, make God their defense. The decree has been passed by the highest earthly authority that they shall worship the beast and receive his mark under the pain of persecution and death. May God help his people now. For what can they do in such a fearful conflict without his assistance? Volume 5, page 213. There are those today who see apostasy in the church, and they honestly believe that they can be a part of change within to stop the apostasy and prevent the church from becoming apostate, something that in their blindness they fail to see the church has already become.
Mm-hmm.
We have been counseled on page 213 of volume 5, page 213. Courage, fortitude, faith, and implicit trust in God's power to save do not come in a moment. Let me just pause. If they don't come in a moment, then it means it takes a little time for them to come, doesn't it? That means that we need to be forming characters today that are steadfast and strong and courageous. Because if we wait till the crisis, brethren, if we wait till events are happening that are totally out of our control, it's going to be too late. Too late. She goes on to say, these heavenly graces are acquired by the experience of years, by a life of holy endeavor and firm adherence to the right the children of God were sealing their destiny. Beset with temptations without number, they knew they must firmly resist or be conquered. Must what? All you got to do is believe, right? Just believe. Just believe. Don't worry about anything else. Just believe. But it says that we must firmly resist. We must make a decision. Now, I'm not saying that we have to grab hold of a pole and push against something or pull against something. That's not what she's talking about. She's talking about that we make a resolute decision that we are going to do what is right because it is right, and we will leave the consequences to God.
Yes.
One of the most fearful thoughts in this testimony called the Seal of God that is in Volume 7 is this statement on page 213. She says, not all who profess to keep the Sabbath will be sealed. Volume 5, 213. And I hope that you will take equally important this next statement from page 214. There are many, even among those who teach the truth to others, who will not receive the seal of God on their foreheads. In other words, there may be ministers here today, it might be me, who's teaching to you, and we don't get the seal of God. Mm-hmm. She says there will be many. She doesn't say there might be some, she says there will be many. Mm-hmm. She says they had the light of truth. They were teaching the truth at one time. They had the light of truth. They knew their master's will. They understood every point of our faith. But they had not corresponding works. And I thought this next part was so vital. These who were so familiar with what?
Prophecy.
What have we been studying here this week?
Prophecy.
Oh, it's not just enough to know the prophecies, is it? These who were so familiar with prophecy and the treasures of divine wisdom should have acted their faith. They should have commanded their households after them, that by a well-ordered family they might present to the world the influence of the truth upon the human heart. Volume 5, page 214. Why are they going to be lost? Why are they going to be lost? Why will they not receive the seal of God? Because these people, they have looked to men, and they have patterned themselves after fallible man. And I'll show you why I believe that. Volume 5, again, page 214. Jesus is the only true pattern. Everyone must now search the Bible for himself upon his knees before God with the humble, teachable heart of a child if he would know what the Lord requires of him. However high any minister may have stood in the favor of God, if he neglects to follow out the light given him of God, if he refused to be taught as a little child, he will go into darkness and satanic delusions and will lead others in the same path. Volume 5, 214. Now, I don't know if you got that or not. But she says that we can know the truth, friends. We might even be teaching the truth. But then we can refuse to be taught as a child, we can lose our favor with God, and we can begin to go into darkness and have satanic delusions, and we can lead other people in the same pathways. Now, I want to say, I love each one of you here. And there's not a person in this movement somewhere here, yonder, disassociated or unassociated with that I don't love and care deeply for. But I feel that if I'm going to receive the seal of God, friends, I must obey what it says. And that includes that there are times that we have to give reproof. And so I want to speak to something very specific. And I will give you the quotes and references. I won't be just giving you my ideas. But there are teachers who were among us at one time and who are still considered true teachers by many, whose teachings I must speak concerning. And I want to make an emphasis here. I'm not dealing with individuals today. You know, if you want to deal with teachings, unfortunately, teachings don't exist without a teacher. Isn't that right? It's almost impossible to totally separate them. And so you can't do that in a sense, but you can focus upon the teachings, not the people, the teachings. And I must speak because there are people who are following today faulty logic of men instead of inspiration. And I want to tell you today that I make no apologies that I love the spirit of prophecy. I make no apologies today for believing in the spirit of prophecy. And I make no apologies today for teaching from the spirit of prophecy. But a dear, beloved friend of mine, in an article entitled "The Opening of My Mind," said this about the spirit of prophecy. I know that for every statement I find to support what I believe, somebody will find another one to contradict it. I am sorry, but that is the way it is. And anyone who is not aware of this is simply very unfamiliar with Ellen White's writings. I first began to see this very clearly in the Godhead controversy, and now I see it in many other areas. So I don't want to be hypocritical and quote to support my point of view when I know that there are statements which equally contradict my point of you. Now, this is a public statement. This was made in a public publication. And I think it needs a public reproof. In a personal letter from this individual, I have found error in her writings referring to Ellen White. But do you understand this? What this dogma is teaching? It's saying that the spirit of prophecy speaks out of both sides of its mouth. And if you want to believe that, you have the right to do that. No one's going to force you to ever believe the Bible, and neither is anyone going to force you to accept the spirit of prophecy. If you have found the spirit of prophecy to be true, you need to be aware of those who you may be sitting under as teachers who have a very different view. I learned something very valuable from the writer of this last article, or this last paragraph. In fact, in this very pulpit, this writer gave a sermon, and it was entitled Reasons to Believe and Reasons to Doubt, about why people sometimes doubt the writings of the spirit of prophecy, but why we have good reasons to believe. And one of the reasons was that it seemed like there were statements that contradicted. But you know, the very same reasons that we think that the spirit of prophecy may have contradictions, we use those exact same reasonings if we wish about the Bible. For example, I won't read the whole verse, but in Malachi chapter 4 and verse 1, it speaks about the destruction of the wicked. It says, they shall burn as an oven, be stubble, leave them neither what? Root nor branch. In Ezekiel 28, speaking about Lucifer, the devil, the originator of all evil, he says, I will bring thee to ashes, never shalt thou be any more. But we also have texts that say this. Their worm shall not die, neither shall their fire be quenched, Isaiah 64:24. Or right there in the three angels' messages, Revelation 14:11, the smoke of their torment ascendeth up forever and ever. I can use the same logic and I can say that I can teach anything I want from the Bible, because the Bible contradicts itself in many places depending on whose version you want to read the doctrine from. Isn't that right?
That's right.
That's right. What we need, friends, when we read these kind of statements in the Bible, we don't throw them out. We don't say the Bible's contradicting. We don't say the Bible's speaking out of both sides of its mouth. What we say is that these statements need understanding, they need further study, but they can and will harmonize.
Yes.
And the same, I believe, with all my heart, is true about Ellen White's writings. I don't believe the Bible teaches different doctrines on a single subject.
Amen.
We can harmonize the text. But in the aforequoted publication, the writer also stated that he used to believe in the post-fall nature of Christ, but has changed his mind on that. His view on the mark of the beast has changed also from the false Sabbath of the papacy to now he is considering that it may be the acceptance of the homosexual movement as being the mark of the beast. This author is also teaching that believing that Christ is not only our substitute, but is our example, is a false perspective, and it lies at the root of a completely different approach to salvation, one legalistic and focused. In other words, if you believe that Christ is both your substitute and your example, that is legalistic, and it is not Christ-focused, it is human-focused. But my Bible says in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 21 and 22, for even hereunto were you called, because Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example. What kind of an example? That ye should follow his steps, who did no sin, neither was guile found in his mouth. The example that Christ set, friends, was an example of walking without sin.
Amen.
He is surely our substitute. But to try to say that if you believe he's substitute and example, and that makes you legalistic and human-focused, I'm sorry. He must be my substitute because, friends, I cannot do anything without him. Jesus said, without me you can do
nothing.
But Paul said, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. But friends, we're talking today about the Day of Atonement. We're talking today about the sealing of the 144,000, more specifically. And I'm not trying to beat a horse, a dead horse. And so what I'm saying applies to any false doctrine that we read anywhere. But specifically, we need to understand the Day of Atonement, for we are living in that day in the sealing time. But I just read this recently in a letter where an individual says, I have concluded that what began in 1844 was the pre-Advent judgment, but not, and that is not my emphasis, it is the author's emphasis, not the Day of Atonement. Adventists have made the investigative judgment and the Day of Atonement the same event, But I conclude this is not so. But what did Ellen White say? We are now living in the great day of atonement. Now. Friends, this is a contrast. This is not a comparison. If one teaches against the spirit of prophecy, if one teaches a faulty view of the incarnation, can that possibly be the true gospel? If one says we're not living the day of atonement today, will true righteousness by faith teach such things if it has especially a wrong view of sin? If one teaches that we're not living the day of atonement, I don't know that that's Adventism anymore. I don't think James White would welcome such teachings in Adventism. I don't think Joseph Bates would extend a hand of fellowship to teachers of these false views. And I don't think Jane Andrews would dare agree with such scholarship and theology. Certainly not Adventism or true Seventh-day Adventism of any kind. It is a darkness that can only lead to delusion. Brethren, if men persist in false doctrine, according to Titus chapter 3 and verse 1, that after the first and second admonition that they are to be rejected. Not 10 or 20 pleadings with them. And Romans chapter 16 verse 17 says that we are to withdraw from them and to avoid them. So why do we have camp meetings together with people who teach these doctrines? I ask you, if you're a speaker at these meetings, why do you go and speak with them when they're teaching these doctrines if you don't believe those things too? Paul says that you're to withdraw. You don't have to believe me. Romans 16, 17. Read what the Word of God says. Don't obey me. Amen. Don't listen to anything I say.
Amen.
Listen to what the Word of God says. But you better know what truth is. And if you disagree with me on what truth is, that's fine. You can do that. But the judgment will show, and God will show, where the truth is.
Amen.
But I would caution every one of us that we have been counseled that the track of truth lies close beside the track of error. And both tracks may seem to be one mind, which are not worked by the Holy Spirit, and which therefore are not quick to discern the difference between truth and error. In other words, beloved, it's easy for us to listen. You might be listening to me today, and you might think I'm teaching everything just right, but I could maybe make a mistake. Maybe I would teach you wrong. You might not know the difference if your mind's not worked by the Holy Spirit. But Jesus knows our need. He knows what we need to do. He has counseled us in Revelation 3:18 to buy the gold tried in the fire, to have the white raiment, to anoint our eyes with the eye salve. We need this. I need it. Do you need it?
Amen.
Say amen.
Amen.
I need it. In volume 5, page 215. And by the way, if you've never read this chapter, you should read it. And if you've read this chapter, please reread it again. It's the most important testimony she ever wrote. I believe. I really do. She says, so long as we choose the easy path of self-indulgence and are frightened at self-denial, our faith will never become firm and we cannot know the peace of Jesus nor the joy that comes through conscious victory. What kind of victory?
Conscious
victory. The most exalted of the redeemed hosts that stand before the throne of God and the Lamb, clad in white, know the conflict of overcoming, for they have come up through great tribulation. My brethren, we cannot invite wolves to feed the sheep. No. Wolves may come in sheep's clothing, but they come in to eat and not feed. I started writing my notes, they come in to feed and not feed, but you know, that might be a little confusing, but we use that word feed both ways, don't we? I feed you. I feed you the Word of God. That's what Paul says. I'm giving you the Word of God. But friends, God has given us truth. And it's a truth that admits of no compromise. And it's a truth about the one who is the way, the truth, and life.
Mm-hmm.
And in volume 5 on page 215, it says, no one need say that his case is hopeless, that he cannot live the life of a Christian. Ample provision is made by the death of Christ for every soul. Jesus is a very present help in time of need. Only call upon Him in faith, and He has promised to hear and answer your petitions. And I think I have Jeremiah 33:3 here, where He says, call unto me, and I will answer thee, and shew thee, what? Great and mighty things which thou knowest not. Now, before we can finish today, I want to just go back to Ezekiel 9, and I want to talk a little bit about this mark. This mark, if you get your concordance out or your Bible software out. It's the Hebrew letter, the last letter of the Hebrew alphabet, the Hebrew letter Tau. And in the time of Ezekiel, this Hebrew character was written in the form of an X. And if you take an X and rotate it 45 degrees, you have a cross. But it's interesting. I just find that interesting because Ellen White says this. What is the seal of the living God which is placed in the foreheads of his people? It is a mark which angels, but not human eyes, can read. For the destroying angel must see this mark of redemption. The intelligent mind has seen what? The sign of the cross of Calvary in the Lord's adopted sons and daughters, Maranatha 2:43. This is not the same cross that Constantine saw and said, go conquer it. Not at all. God wants to mark us, friends, with redemption. The cross of Calvary. I enjoy hiking. I enjoy hiking in the mountains. And sometimes after I've hiked up maybe the 10th mountain of the day, I'm a little tired, not sure I want to hike up another one sometimes. But no matter how high you go, the people who climb K2 and Mount Everest, and they expend tremendous effort to do that, the highest place any human being can ever be is kneeling at the foot of the cross.
Amen.
It's kneeling at the foot of the cross. The Lord Jesus tells us through the Apostle Paul in Romans 3:21-22, but now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets, even the righteousness of God, which is by what?
Faith.
Faith of Jesus Christ unto all and upon all them that believe, for there is no difference. And Revelation 14:12, here's the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. They keep the commandments of God, but they also keep the faith of Jesus. We are told this. It is now. And I want you to notice the nows, four nows in this statement. It is now that we must keep ourselves and our children unspotted from the world. It is now that we must wash our robes of character and make them white in the blood of the Lamb. It is now that we must overcome pride, passion, and spiritual slothfulness. It is now that we must awake and make determined effort for symmetry of character. And then she says, today, that's like now, today if you will hear his voice, of course she's quoting from the prophet, harden not your hearts. Are we in a most trying position, wanting, watching for our Lord's appearing? The world is in darkness, but ye, brethren, says Paul, are not in darkness, that day should overtake you as a thief. It is ever God's purpose to bring light out of darkness, joy out of sorrow, and rest out of weariness for the longing, waiting soul. So take courage, flock. God has made provision for you. He knows your situation. In volume 5, please listen to this statement. Please obey this statement. Those who are uniting with the world are receiving worldly mold and preparing for the mark of the beast. Beloved, you need to examine your life. You need to examine your theology, your teachings, the things that your church is teaching and doing. And if they are drawing you closer to the world, if they are more worldly than they used to be, then you are being prepared for the mark of the beast. In volume 5, also earlier, very near that statement we read on page 83 where she says the church will be weighed in the balances. And by the way, there's another statement very similar in volume 8 of the Testimonies. It's in a chapter called Shall We Be Found Wanting? It's a very important chapter. I encourage you to read it. Volume 8 of the Testimonies, Shall We Be Found Wanting? But she says here, the time is not far distant when the test will come to every soul. That's you, that's me, that's every one of us. The mark of the beast will be urged upon us. Well, friends, we better know what the mark of the beast is. Mm-hmm. Right? Those who have step by step yielded to worldly demands and conformed to worldly customs will not find it a hard matter to yield to the powers that be rather than subject themselves to derision, insult, threatened imprisonment, and death. But friends, instead of step by step accepting or preparing ourselves, I should say, to accept the mark of the beast, we can step by step prepare to receive the seal of God.
Amen.
We can do this. We can receive the seal of God by purifying our souls by obeying the truth. And we are receiving then the heavenly mold and preparing for the seal of God. And this is a fearful message. It is a fearful warning. Ellen White says, not one of us will ever receive the seal of God while our characters have one spot or stain upon them. Now, I've spoke about doctrine some here today. And doctrine is not the same thing as character. But friends, your doctrine molds you. Your doctrine fits you up with a character that relates to that doctrine. And Ellen White, she ended this chapter on the seal of God with these words, and I'm going to end our message today with these same words. Now, another now statement. Now is the time to prepare, beloved. The seal of God will never be placed upon the forehead of an impure man or woman. It will never be placed upon the forehead of the ambitious, world-loving man or woman. It will never be placed upon the forehead of men or women of false tongues or deceitful hearts. All who receive the seal of God must be without spot before God, candidates for heaven. Go forward. She says, go forward, my brethren and sisters. Search the scriptures for yourselves that you may understand the fearful solemnity of the present hour. May God help us each to understand the solemnity of this hour and to fit within the requirements of that hour. May we pray. Our Father in heaven, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Father, for the spirit of prophecy that you've given to your people, and we do love it, and we do appreciate it. And I confess, Father, that I need to come in far better line with many things that you have instructed us, and I want to do that right now. I want to step by step lead my life to be molded in the character of Christ, in the character that will be able to endure your presence and live. And it's my prayer that each one here will. And Father, it's my prayer that those who have taught things that are not what we have believed in the past, this platform of truth that you gave to our people and have started to veer off and even teach others to veer off, that you will speak to their hearts because you love them and we love them and we want them saved in your kingdom, Father. And I pray that you will help us all to go into heaven together and to be one body.
Yes.
Because we have one Lord, one faith, and one God. And so, Father, have mercy upon your people this day. Speak to our hearts. And I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.